Hello, good afternoon. Welcome to this session. Our next session is called Achieving Climate Action Through Integrated Policies for Co-Benefits. This session, along with all the others, is supported by Climate Compatible Growth, CCG for short, and CCG is funded by the FCDO, the UK's Foreign Commonwealth Development Office.
If you wish to ask a question at all throughout the event, please use Slido. The link is www.slido.com and the code is 2715656. The information is online for you and also in the room for those in here. So now I would like to introduce you to our chair of today's session, Meron Tess Michael. She is a Doctor Senior Research Fellow at UCL in London. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone, and it's good to have you all in this room and also online. Today, we're going to be talking about achieving climate action through integrated policies for co-benefits. So basically, we all know that economic and social development is a priority and primary challenge for low and middle-income countries. At the same time, there is also, therefore, any climate change actions and commitments need to consider development priorities and identify a practical approach to the climate development nexus. So some of the critical questions that are being asked around these issues is, like, for example, what are the issues to consider when strategizing around the integration of climate agendas and development priorities? Also, more importantly, how can we ensure economic developments without leaving climate imperatives, but at the same time also how can we make sure that our economic initiatives do not leave some communities worse off? And this includes governance issues, institutional arrangements, as well as removing hindrances, whether investment, finance, and other areas. So in these sessions, we're going to try to aim to pack some of those issues and draw from our panelists' research and work experience. One of the panelists who was going to join us was Mr. John Benanda. John Benanda is an environment and social inclusion specialist at the Ministry of Green Economy and Environment in Zambia. But unfortunately, due to unforeseen events, he was not able to join us. But here, my colleague Mulima has been kind enough to step in his place and give us his presentation, also contribute her own input, which she has a lot to say. Mulima Nyamba Mumba Mubanga is a research fellow at the Zambian Institute for Policies Analysis and Research, or ZIPAR, in Zambia. She works on policy aspects relating to climate change, sustainable development, and environmental sustainability. Mulima is also a co-investigator on a UKRI Global Challenge Research Fund project in collaboration with UCL on energy democracy and the politics of energy transition in Africa. And she is also a lead researcher on COVID-19, greening the social and economic recovery in Ghana and Zambia, which I had a great pleasure to work with. She is also currently a chairperson of the technical working group formulating the Zambia National Green Growth Strategy. We also have Dr. Navroz Dabash, who is a professor at the Center for Policy Research and a New Delhi-based think tank and an adjunct research, senior research fellow at the Lee Kuan Yew School of Public Policy. He has been recently engaged in global and national debates on climate change, air quality, energy, and water as a researcher, policy advisor, as well as an activist for over 25 years. Navroz has been a coordinating lead author for the chapter on policies and institutions for the sixth assessment report of the ICC and has worked to inform and advise Indian government policymaking on climate change, energy, and water policy on the last decade. In the early 1990s, he has helped to establish the Global Climate Action Network as its first international coordinator. Third, we have Dr. Philip Trotter, who I'm sure a lot of people in this room and also online might know as a member of the CCG program, as well as a professor of sustainability management at the University of Wurtemberg. I meant to ask you this and then I forgot.
It's okay.
Excellent. And also, He's an honorary research associate at Oxford University. Philip has a PhD in mechanical engineering from the University of Oxford and an MSc in politics from London School of Economics in the UK. Kind of things that good to combine in this world. His research is an interdisciplinary and addresses the nexuses of energy, sustainable development, and private sector in Africa. He has published in world-leading academic journals, and which has led to collaboration with international organizations, including World Bank, African Development Bank, UNDP, and several African and European governments. So, with that, I will pass this to Philip to start us on this Navros to start us on this conversation. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks so much, Miriam. It's good to keep us all on our toes. A little unpredictability there in the order. Thanks very much. This is a topic that I'm really invested in, this question of integrated approaches for co-benefits. And I warned Philip that I might be a little abstract, which I suppose is okay as the opening panelist, but I know we'll get into a lot more detail as we go along. So the starting point for me in thinking about this question, integrated policies for co-benefits in developing economies, is the observation that these are rapidly changing economies. These are economies where that are in flux socially, politically, economically, which has a lot of some positive effects in the sense that we haven't made a lot of choices. We haven't locked into certain growth paths. There's some room to experiment with this. But the challenge, of course, is that the task here becomes very hard, which is that you have to decarbonize while increasing energy use. And let's be very clear, we do have to increase energy use in all these countries. You can't put increasing energy use on hold until we solve this decarbonization problem. So you need to increase energy use, you need to decarbonize, and we have to do that while creating jobs, while taking care of other problems like air pollution, for example, in India, and I'll use a lot of Indian examples, while avoiding increased vulnerability to climate impacts. And so the multiple objectives that one has to hit simultaneously is the nature of the challenge that we have here, right? Which is, and I will add that a lot of the knowledge that, or the purported knowledge that gets brought to this question from outside these countries ends up being knowledge that is developed in very different contexts, where basic energy needs are met, where you have infrastructure more or less built, and so on and so forth, right? So there is a sort of a knowledge story here. So the analytical task is much harder, and the implementation task is harder, because often you have institutions that are overstretched, you have political and economy linkages that are really kind of contorted and twisted. So I'll give you one example. You know, we're talking about after the Glasgow COP, there was lots of talk about coal phase down versus phase out and India's role and so on and so forth. Well, the kinds of things India would have to deal with if we tried to phase out coal or phase down coal is that coal and coal freight cross-subsidizes passenger rail in India, which is politically a really important issue because you have this huge migrant population. So if you just pluck coal out of the freight story, passenger rail will go up, which is a huge political cost for any government. It's not something that one thinks about right away when you think about coal, but it's all this kind of enmeshing that's really hard. So the opportunity side of the story, which I think does exist, is to say we're rapidly changing. We have the chance to ask, what kind of societies do we want to build? What kind of cities do we want to build? What kind of agricultural systems? How do we want to create jobs? How do we want to use the sort of potential of renewable energy maybe to also democratize energy? These are all openings that we have, but they're not just openings. They're also challenges. So how do we go about addressing this challenge? And I just want to sort of pause by saying that the first entry point to this is to avoid the trap of thinking that developing countries as a whole have a common entry point. That this language, it's a phrase that we should ban from our vocabulary, which is best practice. You know, I just don't think such a thing is really useful. Instead, and I'm looking at Jakob here, the paper that he and Yuba and many others did recently, which looked at the context-dependent nature of the energy transition across African countries, I think was a really, really great paper. And the challenge is, how do we take context really seriously in this? So analytically then, what is the task? The task is to figure out, how do we address multiple and linked objectives? So decarbonization, sure, that's part of the story, but growing energy needs, growing resilience, distributional concerns, air quality, as I said, in some countries, et cetera, et cetera. How do we understand whether particular changes or particular policy levers, how do they affect these multiple objectives? It's an analytical question. In some cases, there are synergies. In some cases, there are trade-offs, right? And this is the co-benefit story. The co-benefit story leads us to ask this question analytically. When are there synergies? When are there trade-offs? How do we maximize synergies? How do we minimize trade-offs? And we shouldn't think that there are all synergies or all trade-offs, right? That it depends. Again, and it may vary by context. And then from that co-benefit story, I would say, taking a page from the recent IPCC report, is to say that it's not just a static question. You have a choice about how you develop over time. And this language of development pathways that the IPCC puts forward is, you know, to use a sort of loose language, is kind of co-benefits on rails, if you like, right? It's like co-benefits over time. You actually get a choice about how do you develop in ways that maximize those co-benefits, but it's not a static question, it's a dynamic question. So that then, I don't want to go on too long, so I got another 2 or 3 minutes, is that okay? So this idea of development pathways then, how do we take that forward? And there are three sort of analytical questions or three themes that I want to sort of explore very quickly. The first, again, starting with the context dependent point, is it's not just a physical context, it's also a political context. If you're going to do a low carbon development strategy, it has to be something, and you know, we all aspire to rich democracies. Some of us do better or worse at different times. Certainly that's true in my country of recent times. But we the question is, how do we tell a narrative about a development future that also wins political support? Because if it doesn't win political support, and let me give you another phrase that I think we should ban, which is political will, right? What does that mean to have more political? Do you say that, you know, a strong politician is one who will do whatever it takes to get himself or herself tossed out of office? I mean, that's not the nature of politics, right? So it's not about political will, it's about creative politics, right? Finding a way to actually meet voters express needs in ways that are also sustainable in financial terms and other terms and so on. So what is the narrative that holds in a country? It might be a jobs-led co-benefits narrative. And I always think of South Africa, which was the darling of the kind of climate community back in the 2000s because it had this peak, plateau, and decline trajectory, which was a mitigation-oriented trajectory. And along comes, you know, Zuma and others and says, you know, where's the, and part of it was obviously problematic politics in South Africa, but part of it was right. Where's the job story in that? It's a mitigation narrative. Peak, plateau, and decline. It's all about mitigation. And now I think South Africa is kind of rebuilding its politics around a just transition story, which I think has much more resonance. So the political narrative matters. The second is, you may have a narrative, you may have politics, you may even have policy ideas. And you may even have targets, because all of our countries now have targets because of NDCs. But what you need to knit all these together are also institutions. Are we building the institutions, are we retooling government, both around mitigation and around adaptation, to address the challenges of climate change? And there's three things at minimum that institutions need to do. One is coordination, because one thing that's clear is that climate change is not something that's amenable to silos, right? Urbanization meets energy, means building design, meets energy policy. These are all things that have to be interlinked. Same on the resilience side, whether it's agriculture, water, the economic policies that support agriculture, and so on. So it's integration. The second is kind of a strategy setting approach. If this is something, if climate change is something where we're on a clock, and we are, then how do those targets get set? How does that then loop back into policy? How does the monitoring happen? And here, a model that gets thrown out a lot is from the UK, the UK Climate Change Committee. In my own view, I think that's a really interesting model because the CCC doesn't have authority to set, it doesn't have authority to enforce, but its authority lies from its analysis and its signaling effects. But we've been arguing in India that what makes sense is actually to have a low-carbon development committee, where you don't set 5-yearly budgets, but you put the authority of a committee behind this co-benefits and development pathway analysis, right? And you put make that an object of discussion. And the third thing that institutions need to do for you is to help you build consensus, because the transformations that we're talking about bring winners and losers, and the losers have to be compensated in some way. It's the essence of the just transition story. South Africa has this wonderful example of its presidential commission, which I think is a really useful model. The last thing, I'll just take a few seconds on this, is about finance, right? You have to have the means to drive these changes. And here on finance, I have a bit of a conflicted view, because I think this language of additionality that has is suffused the climate finance conversation, where the donor side says, show us the additionality of your action. And the recipient side, show us the additionality of your finance, right? And actually what we want to do is we do want to integrate climate change into financial decisions. We do want everyday planning to involve climate considerations, right? You don't want to build your public transport system without thinking about climate change, for both on the resilience side as well as on the mitigation side. But you also don't want that to become an excuse for saying there are some real costs here for which we will need external finance. We need external finance to manage the transaction costs, right? So in India, if you take away fossil fuels, it leaves a big hole on the fiscal side. The fiscal side, the fiscal revenues are heavily dependent right now on fossil fuel in India, for example. Access to credit, we have much higher costs of capital in India. That has to be brought down if you're going to move to a renewable energy economy. And of course, there are the adaptation costs, the loss and damage costs, and so on. So the argument about additionality shouldn't be taken to mean that we don't need, that finance isn't important. But I do think also we shouldn't get trapped into this conversation where we say, well, if we do that on our own steam, that means no money will be forthcoming, right? And there are examples of that. I'll give you one very small example and then I'll end, which is, a decade or two ago, when the conversation was about moving from incandescent to LED to CFL bulbs, there was actually a project that said, hang on a second, if we go ahead and switch to CFLs, which would be really helpful because we won't have to build additional coal-fired power plants, then we won't be able to get CDM credits for that transition. So let's not do it, right? That's the kind of perverse logic that the additionality story takes you into. Okay, so I'm just going to stop there. I think that part of the story is the imagination of what kind of societies you want to build. That's where it really has to start. And then to realize that is to build a political narrative, to back it up by institutions, and make sure that there's finance to get the whole thing moving. So that's the sort of high-level story that I try and bring to this question.
That is indeed a high-level story, and also an extreme ask for a lot of countries, especially in sub-Saharan Africa, or maybe India also presents a much more complex context as well as a much more advanced conversation in these areas. But I think Philip is going to bring us back into sub-Saharan Africa.
Yeah. Not exclusively, I hope, so to a certain extent. I had some slides, so maybe we can bring those up. Lovely, thank you very much. So I'll talk about this interesting, and then this interesting issue of the difference between formally adopting climate policies and actually, what has to happen for those climate policies to actually make a tangible impact on the ground. And I'll touch on several things that Navras was talking about. Just maybe, well, clicker doesn't seem to work. Maybe you can just go to the next slide. Well, we do it like that. Yeah. So there's three key messages that I wanted to talk about. The first one is that there is certainly a disconnect between what people have said they want to do, and some of the ambitions that they have. Thank you. Some of the ambitions that they have, and the concrete action that we see on the ground, and was actually implemented. And there's, you know, some hard numbers, and there's also, you know, some soft anecdotal evidence that there is a gap. The second is, studying that gap, and that's what we did in a research project that I led. Jakob was involved in several other scholars from Asia and Africa as well. So we looked at low and middle income countries, and asked policymakers, people that were representing these countries in climate negotiations and policy consultants, just to understand what drives policy adoption and formal, commitment to targets, and what drives actual implementation of these policies. And we found quite different, a different set of drivers that are salient for implementation rather than adoption. So I think there was a huge focus, of course, in Paris, and also the aftermath of Paris and the NDC focuses on this adoption on the target side, but maybe not as much on what does it take to actually lead to tangible outcomes. And I think there I'll talk a lot about what we found. There was a lot on what Navroz was talking about, these multiple objectives that certainly are there. They really come into play when you talk about implementation. You can write a lot of things on paper. Maybe it's not. Yeah, okay, thank you. I think Navroz maybe has fixed it already. Okay, so you can put a lot of things on paper, but actually, implementing that is potentially more difficult. And the third thing is then we asked and we studied what type of measures there are to bridge this gap. And there's a lot that low and middle income countries can do themselves, and there's a bunch of things that the international community can do as well. So I'll talk about that. So maybe can we switch to the next slide, please? Yeah, that was a few too many. Yeah, that one is perfect. So let's just go into the first one. So this is from the Climate Action Tracker. I haven't found a recent update for COP27. This is the COP26 update they made. But you can say, thank you very much, but you can see quite a notable difference here between the policies and actions and then the targets only. And then you can see my face down here, but this is where the pledges and targets are. And then these are kind of some of the scenarios. So you see this difference in what the actual concrete actions are telling us, and what some pledges and targets are. And I really was interested, by how can we bridge this gap. So, in addition to that, then we asked, we looked at 11 different low and middle income countries, and we just asked respondents and these policymakers and the climate negotiators, do you see a gap between adaptation and implementation? And pretty much all of the countries except for Benin and Ethiopia, I think, were the two examples that didn't see much of a gap. But the others, there were a lot of these statements where you said, climate change is high on the agenda in terms of policy, but in terms of implementation, it's a different story, right? And they were mentioning ideas like, Angola has this big tree planting initiative that they have on paper, but the amount of trees they're actually planting is very low, but they're still doing a lot of logging. So if you look at kind of this, some of the measures, there seems to be this disconnect in several of these low and middle income countries that we studied. And Bolivia, Ghana, Nigeria is a similar story here. So let's what we then decided to do is look at can we come up with a framework that would look at the different drivers of formal adoption of climate policies and implementation. And just from a literature review, I don't want to go through all of these ones, but you can what we saw, what is out there, is there are certain internal drivers. So something that comes from your own country, and external drivers that come from the international community, and you can divide them into political, environmental, economic, and sociocultural type drivers that are either existent on within your country or without. And then we, just with all these respondents, would go through and ask them, what is driving formal adoption, what is driving implementation. And what we found is quite a different, here we go, let's just start with this one. So we found quite a different pattern. So this is a policy adoption. So, you know, the process of, committing to the Paris Agreement and implementing or adopting policies in NDCs and climate policies that would foster these goals. So what people are saying, you know, what drove this is the answer that almost everybody gets was this external political pressure, where the low-income countries, of course, were also in this Paris Agreement, were also asked to also sign the Paris Agreement, and almost all low- and middle-income countries did sign the Paris Agreement. And of course, there was, this international, political kind of agreement that low-income countries would sign up to the Paris Agreement, and then high-income countries would potentially finance some of the measures that would have to be there. And internally, you had this political aspect, which was quite important for adoption. So you had, this political, or conviction that countries want to take part of in this process, and you had, certainly this environmental issue because of the high impacts that low and middle income countries would suffer from climate change. So there was, just addressing this on the global area was quite important. But now, if you look at those drivers and compare them to what is happening on the implementation side, so what drives these policies to actually make a change on the ground, you see quite different sets of drivers. So, for instance, the economic one, economic co-benefits and also social co-benefits were all of a sudden, amongst the most important ones. You do have to have, political institutions and the political ability also to drive that change. But it's really about whether these policies have a tangible economic impact and a tangible social positive impact for countries to be to really focus on. And externally as well, if there's an economic, a benefit that can be had, or the consequence of not implementing them could lead to economic issues in terms of climate finance that wouldn't be there, for instance, or climate finance just as a driver for actually implementing that those were the other ones. So you really see, adoption you can get through political pressure, but whether that actually happens on the implementation side, the politics don't really matter that much. It's much more about whether it actually makes sense economically and socially, and that's really, something that Navros was talking about with the multiple objectives and which ones are salient here. Right, and then we just looked at different, it's just kind of a summary, and then different driver types, which ones are really, really salient. I called it political leadership. So I don't know if political will, we just heard that's not really the right term. I don't know if we can settle on leadership and leadership ability, which is important for both adoption and implementation. But a lot of these economic and also social aspects are quite salient on the implementation side. So, sorry. So what can be done to make sure that these policies that are being adopted at a large scale that are actually being implemented? So this is the key measures that you can take, and I just picked a couple here for the internal side, what countries can do. It really starts with from top down, and this top down leadership. In Ethiopia, we saw something like that started really under Meles Zenawi when he was president, where there was a strong focus. And in 2009, I think there was this integrated policies push that they really wanted to grow their economy and become kind of a green growth superstar. And there was a lot of policy making, very cross sectoral in the setup that was driven in that way. And I'm a professor of sustainability management, so I look at a lot at businesses, and the example, I think actually some political or organizations and governments can actually learn from the private sector here as well. And there's this very interesting case of Unilever, which is one of the, you know, premier companies that have really engaged in the sustainability transition of this entire organization. And Unilever is a very, very big company. And how they did it, you know, is that there was a new CEO that came in, and in 2009, Paul Polman, and he, you know, in the first year, he fired a third of top and middle management. So he threw out, I think, 34 or something of the top 100 managers in the company, and came with this vision of, we need to transform what Unilever is all about. And the vision was not about just making profits, but it was about, you know, environmental and social objectives while keeping prosperity. And the way what they then did is they went into all business units. So there's a CEO of sustainability in Unilever. And they have the power to go into all business units and incentivize these business units and give them targets that say, you know, not only your market share has to be X or your profit has to be Y, but it says your carbon footprint can only be this much, your social impact, your job impact, your biodiversity impact has to be, you know, at this level over a certain time, and it has to be ramped down. If you don't, then you just have failed as a manager and you don't get your bonus. So they would tie that to this. And so, you know, it's an interesting example how kind of from the top down you can implement something like that throughout organizations. And, you know, there is on the institutional side now, there are a couple of initiatives that we're seeing now where these cross-sectoral governance approaches that we also heard about in the last session are actually taking place. So in Benin, for instance, we have a Ministry of the Living Environment and Sustainable Development. We have, of course, in Zambia, we have a Ministry of the Green Economy. And in Germany, just now, the new government in Germany has this Federal Ministry of Economic Affairs and Climate Action. In Singapore, we have a very long tradition. I think the Ministry of Sustainability and the Environment in Singapore is 50 years old this year. So it's an idea that has existed for quite a long time, where certain governments are creating these institutional spaces to, you know, do what Navros was saying, that you have to foster this consensus across these different spheres and equip them institutionally with the means to do so. Right, and then on the international community side, the finance aspect, I think Navros covered that. It's exactly what we found in this paper as well. The cross-ministerial, you know, development pathways, and there's also this notion that Navros was also talking about, that this is not a static type approach, and it's very much context dependent and also time dependent. And there's, I think, a skills issue as well, because the complexity of governance across sectors is, of course, a lot higher, because you have to understand all these different sectors. So there you need to build these skills in governance. So that was pretty much my talk. Thank you. I'll hand it back to Meron. Thank you.
That's excellent. Thank you. There is, obviously, I'm going to let Mulima do the presentation before I get into the questions, but a question that I would like all three of you to think about and to come back to. There is a lot of talk about a top-down approach to core benefits and policies, and I understand there is a practical element that go into making that a top-down and then making institutionalized system creating. But what I haven't been hearing a lot is about creating a bottom-up approach, creating a demand for core benefits policies. And how do you make citizens see there is a benefit in policies that kind of merging both development and climate policies? And therefore, would that be one way to tackle the political economy issue that comes when it comes to the implementation of those policies? Before that, but now we're going to go into a more specific case studies that Mulima is going to share with us, which is an interesting perspective that is more focused in a country.
Thank you, Meron. Could we have the slide deck up? Okay. So my name is Mulima Nyambe Mbanga. I'm making a presentation on behalf of John, who's unable to present it. So John works for the Ministry of Green Economy. So the guidelines that I'll speak to that were developed in 2019-2020 that look at climate screening. So we're trying to see how the climate policy landscape is looking like. And then there's also a tool to just track how we're achieving the climate action through integrated policies for core benefits. Oh. Let's see if it's working. Okay. So, interestingly, for Zambia, we are pursuing a green growth agenda, and at the same time, we are also pursuing a decentralization agenda. So we're talking about climate actions at both national and sub-national level. And we have a Ministry of Green Economy and Environment, so hopefully we'll get it right with respect to benefits. We need a coordinated approach. So I'll be speaking to the climate change screening guidelines and the screening tool that was developed. And basically, it's to guide the process of ensuring that our climate policy landscape or the framework is actually looking at attaining the SDGs and also what we've set out in the nationally determined contributions. But more so, where are the gaps? I think most low middle-income countries work in silos, so you have ministries that are tackling climate actions in various ways, but they're not really coming together to make sure that the impacts trickle down to the masses. Like I indicated earlier, so the tool and the guidelines are basically to help the policymakers and also the technocrats to ensure that we see how best we can mainstream climate change in the policy framework and how is it operating, how is the response even to the communities where you're actually implementing those aspects. Now, the guiding principles for the guidelines and the two are basically to ensure that we integrate climate change in the policy framework. And of course, it's a cross-sectoral approach that is taken in this regard because it's not a one-size-fits-all, but at the end of the day, the policies need to converge to meet our ambitious nationally determined contribution and also the SDGs. And then how adaptive are the policies, the strategies? We have recently launched our 8th National Development Plan, and I'm happy to report that we have one of the core pillars in the plan is the environmental sustainability bit. So already we're seeing that our national priorities are also looking at environmental sustainability. So in a way, because we are also pursuing a green growth agenda, most of the policies have to be revised to ensure that they're not just mentioning climate change without really speaking to how they're going to implement. And that's something we found on the study we did with Meron and Jacob and Bernard. We found that there was mention of the climate change, but when you to zero in on the implementation and the activities, it was silent. So you start wondering what is going on, because if you're talking about infrastructure development, there's nothing there. So these are just some of the guiding principles to ensure that, one, the policies, the strategies, the plans are realistic and responsive and able to adapt to the climate risks that obtain. Okay. I'm not sure. Brilliant. So the conceptual framework around the climate change screening guidelines that we are using are in three stages. So stage one is looking at a preliminary assessment. So you map the policy landscape and also the institutional arrangements. Who is responsible for what and what is the policy saying in a respective sector? And then the second stage is the screening tool application. So at this point, we screen against the development policy framework. So it looks at both the international and national aspects. So with respect to the SDGs, where are we? With respect to the Paris Agreement, the NDCs, where are we? And then you zero into the national level. What are the agencies, government agencies, even private sector doing just to make sure that we attain what we've pledged at NDC level? Then there's also the aspect to look at, the climate change policy framework. And you also look at the aspect to do with climate change risks and vulnerabilities. So where are the risks? Where are the vulnerabilities? I think we've been talking about the inclusion. So how do we avert some of these issues? So you screen to make sure that in each sector, you know what the risks are and where the vulnerabilities are. And then you come up with actions that will mitigate the impacts. Then the last stage is the climate change responsive assessment. So where are we, where are the priorities, and what are the actions arising from the two stages? And if you look at that, the M&E component is very, very important. I think many a times we come up with actions, but we don't follow through to see how it has impacted. We've banned the use of best practice, so I don't even know what to say now. So it's a matter of learning, so drawing lessons from what you've done. So where are you? Where are you coming from? Where are you? Where do we want to be? So the M&E component is quite cardinal here. And I'm happy to also report that our government has developed the national policy on monitoring and evaluation. So it will be very interesting to see how this will encompass some of these aspects. So at least we're assured that the line ministries and other government departments will also be aligned to the national policy on monitoring and evaluation. So this is just to give you a glimpse of some of the guiding questions when we're undertaking the screening. We want to be aware, what is the mandate of, say, the Ministry of Energy or Ministry of Transport? Do they, if they have aspects that are related to climate change, what exactly are they doing? But remember, I mentioned that we have the Ministry of Green Economy and Environment. So they're the ones who are now going to coordinate. Still waiting to see what their mandate is, because we still have a lot of other agencies stating various things. Then you're wondering, where is the ministry? But I think we're getting there. So this is very, very important to make sure that you have a ministry that coordinates what other ministries are doing with respect to climate change. Then it addresses the issue to do with the overlapping mandates. So before, we had the Ministry of Green Economy and Environment, we had the Ministry of Lands and Natural Resources, so they were quite critical in dealing with aspects to do with climate change. So they're still there, there's a department, so we're trying to see how we make sure that the overlapping is also managed there. And then, of course, in all this, the ministry can't work alone. So the interagency coordination is very, very cardinal here. Who is responsible for what, the coordination gaps, and this is where the ministry comes in. And there are various technical working groups that have been
put in place. So structures are there already for us. It's just a matter of how we need to strengthen them. So that one is quite cardinal. And then the budget allocations, I think we're talking about how we need financing to mete out these climate actions, whether it's at national level or sub-national level. It's quite important, because you'll find that when you would delve into the policies, they have an activity, but the financing is not very clear where it's going to come from. So just a reminder, I'm almost done. So the purpose for the two is to interrogate the level of integration of climate change considerations, because it's one thing to mention, oh, we're going to put up climate resilient infrastructure, and you just go quiet. You don't really know what exactly you're going to do. Come rainy season, the bridges are washed out, and then you go like, oh, we didn't know that was going to happen. So it's all those things. And then even just identifying the gaps and opportunities for further mainstreaming, because some policies are silent. So because of the cross-sectoral approach that we're now pursuing, because of the green growth agenda that we're pursuing, is quite important to ensure that the mainstreaming is across all sectors. This is just speaking to some of the entry points for the climate change mainstreaming. Whether we're reviewing a policy or we're developing new policies, so there's the issue identification, agenda setting, the policy formulation, the policy adoption and policy implementation, as well as the M&E bit. I think I already spoke to some of these issues earlier. This is just a glimpse of how the policy database looks like. Now, the key there, if it's red, it means it's quite urgent. This is a sector that is vulnerable to climate shocks, and we need to ensure that the climate narrative is quite clear. So this one looks at the integrated district integrated development plans, just picking that one. Because we're pursuing a decentralization agenda, we now need to look at sub-national level, how exactly are we going to address some of these issues to make sure that if it's the constituency development funds, can we use that to make sure that there's a bit of climate financing to make sure that we mete out the climate actions. And then, so the climate change screening tool is an Excel-based tool. So this is how it looks like. So that was just giving you an example of some of the tools. Oh, I'm done. Thank you.
I was rushing. Am I? Yeah.
But Mulema, why your mic is still hot? Maybe we can ask the question with you. We have heard about the broader challenges, as well as also the drivers and implementation abilities. So what do you think has changed the conversation in Zambia for the ministry to be able to kind of develop this kind of instrument more recently?
Okay. So because of the trajectory that we're pursuing, everyone now sees that they need to come to the table. Meron, I think I mentioned to you that some of the key ministries, because we're talking about decarbonizing, I'm giving an example, decarbonizing the transport sector. We are now revising our national transport policy, believe it or not, because before it was mentioning decarbonization of the transport sector, but not very clear. So the core benefits, in a way, are coming out, and more so because of the decentralization agenda. So at sub-national level, we have alive to the fact that the inclusivity bit is quite cardinal. So we are also using the bottom-up approach. The top-bottom hasn't really worked. I am a social scientist, and I always talk about how if you're going to have a climate action, we are pursuing the utilization of renewable energy technologies in the country. So we find that when we set up those technologies in the rural communities, because it was a top-bottom approach, they vandalize the technologies. So we need to rethink. So everyone needs to know that this is for our good. How are we going to benefit? So because of that bit now, we have structures on the ground that address climate action. And then the financing, I mentioned that there's financing that is available at sub-national level. So one of the things that ZIPA is trying to recommend is that part of those funds for the constituency, the Constituency Development Fund, that's what we call it, can we have a component that deals with climate financing so that the actions, because all communities have got different needs. The impacts on the climate change are different. Other regions are dealing with droughts, others is flash floods. So if it's flash floods, are talking about infrastructure needs. And if it's the droughts you're talking about now, we need to do irrigation farming. So how do we do that? So the financing for the smallholder farmers is not available. So that's how we're just trying to make sure that sub-national level also actions are addressed in a certain way. So the bottom-up approach seems to be working a wee bit, but we'll see how far along we'll get with it. Yeah?
Yes, excellent. Actually, this is actually a good one to go back to Narvos to ask about these issues about bottom-up. In Zambia, we can see that real-time experience of climate-related crisis is forcing governments to think around not only how to resolve it, but also then at the same time provide services. And Narvos, a while back, I am putting you on the spot, I know. A while back, I have read a paper where you talk about equity framing when you talk about climate politics. And this might be a good way also to think about how we can frame these issues in a way that are accessible and relevant and useful for citizens, as well as also for countries that do not feel they are in a position to think about climate and climate benefits issues at an international level. So maybe both on domestic and on international level. I remember, I think that's what the paper was about.
Thank you. I'll do my best to dredge that up from my memory. But if I could just take a second on the bottom-up part of the story. You know, I often feel conflicted because I think that we're not going to manage the scale of this low carbon transition, either on the mitigation side or the resilience side, without the state working more effectively. Right? You have to, and I think this, I was really fascinated by the example that the Zambia story, and I'm actually very curious to know, maybe I can talk to you afterwards, how has that actually worked when you step through each of those points in that flow diagram? You know, what because it's conceptually a very rich framework, but how has it actually worked? But that's exactly the kind of approach to retooling the state that I think, at least from my observation, feels needs to be done. And nothing that rich exists in the Indian context, at least. None that systematic exists in the Indian context, certainly. So then when you talk about the state, does that then mean that everything has to be kind of a top-down construct? And I don't think it does, but that's where political culture and context really matters, right? So all of these institutions that we're building, they've got to be porous to civil society. That includes, if you're doing green industrial policy, you have to be able to have a conversation with business without being captured by business. If you're doing urban planning or agricultural resilience, it has to be porous to civil society, farmers groups, local self-help groups, whatever else it might be. In India, we have these resident welfare associations in cities. It has to be open to them, again, in ways where there's a productive conversation, but not necessarily captured. So, but there's not much, that depends on whether you have a deliberative culture on which to build. And let me also just use that moment to clarify perhaps a little bit, even maybe slightly soften my language on best practice, right? I feel like the best practice idea doesn't mean that you can't learn from other countries, but the best practice is the starting point of the conversation, not the ending point of the conversation. Just because it works somewhere else, it's worth thinking about whether to import it, But then you have to have an embedding process where you say, in what ways will it work here? To what ways would it might be misused here? And so on and so forth. Right. So it's the starting point, not the. It shouldn't be, oh, it worked there. There's something wrong with you if it didn't work here. No, I mean, it's a different context. It's understandable if it works differently. So I think there's a. So we have to have both the kind of bottom-up and the top-down kind of conversation. Let me quickly sort of try and see if I can answer the equity question, because I know that's where I took it in a completely different direction. But in India, at least, the global equity story has been one that has been used to insulate Indian development stories from climate conversations. We didn't cause it. We shouldn't have to talk about it. We should be able to go along our merry way doing high carbon development if that's what we choose to do. And I've been one of those who sort of says, well, you know, we're not innocent of knowledge now. And there are countries, there are Indians who are very vulnerable, and there are other countries that are very vulnerable. So we do have an obligation. And it's the distinction that somebody I look up to in India has made between responsibility for climate change, where we may not have it, but responsibility to internalized climate change, where I think we do have it. And so equity isn't a get out of jail free card, but it is something one has to nonetheless take seriously in terms of how if there is an there are costs to be borne from this, then we do have a claim that those costs should be borne by countries that had a bigger role in causing this problem. I can't remember actually the paper that you were referring to, but that's the.
Like I said, it was a long time ago.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Philip, I think I'm going to go to a couple of questions that have come from the audience, which actually also happen to be the questions that I had in mind. So I'm just going to ask them, two or three of them together, and see how we go. So one is looking into the Unilever case study, which is an interesting example. But the question is, can you confidently say there is no greenwashing and monitoring and reporting in open and transparent to the public? And the other one is... Oh, the other one might be slightly different, but I'm going to ask it anyway. It's is there a way we can think of co-benefits as precondition for climate financing? Do you want to grab them both at the same time?
Yeah, sure. Thank you. So let me talk about the Unilever case. I mean, I'm not a Unilever employee. I'm not in the C-suite. So, you know, it's sometimes a bit tough to judge on greenwashing. What Unilever has done, which is quite remarkable, which you don't really see that much. So this plan is now in its 12th or 13th year. And after 10 years, they published this huge report where they took stock and compared on all, I think they have something like 60 or 70 targets across economics, environment, and social, and were extremely honest and said that about half of those targets, they missed the mark by a lot, and you know, go really into detail on what they can do to make it better. So they're not afraid of saying, you know, we have failed here, we need to do better, and we have done well here. So that gives me confidence that there is kind of, you know, that they're trying to shy away from it. And it's certainly, you know, the CEO, there's all these, you know, public conversations between the CEO and funders and stakeholders and shareholders, right, where they are really getting at each other's throats, and the shareholders saying, hey, you know, you're doing all the sustainability stuff, but, you know, you're not profitable anymore. And, you know, that says, like, you know, we're suffering from this. And he's like, you know, constantly kicking and pushing back against that. So I think there are some signs that the level of greenwashing is not as high as I would say in your average company, although there are still issues with Unilever, right? It's definitely not at the end or nowhere near the end of its sustainability journey, but I think it is a very insightful case in terms of how, you know, these really big organizations, how you can transform them in a short time. You know, before I make a point on the co-benefits for climate finance, I just wanted to briefly touch upon the top-down versus bottom-up issue. And I actually believe that if you are real about co-benefits, then you can't not do it without a bottom-up approach, because the co-benefits, as Navras was saying, is inherently multi-objective. It's a multi-objective issue. So you're looking at economics and the triple bottom line, like economics, social, and environmental aspects, and you can't really understand those without talking to the stakeholders that have these objectives. I mean, how can you even know what your objective is if you don't know the needs of communities? So you have to, if you take this seriously, I would be hard pressed to even say how you do that properly without combining a top down and a bottom up approach. So I think it's a very good question and something to think about. Again, it raises the complexity, but that's absolutely necessary to do here. And then, can co-benefits be catalyzer for finance? I think absolutely yes, because we've heard in previous sessions here today. Where there actually is, climate finance available, but a lot of the times these projects aren't bankable, and then it's really tough to even access the finance. I think there's some research done. I forgot by whom, by Carbon Brief, or I don't know what. But the developed countries have still not managed to go to $100 billion per year, sadly. But if you look at kind of who gets the money that is being put out there, there's a lot of extremely vulnerable countries right now that are not getting any of this funding, and that's mainly because there's some processual issues and there's bankability issues. So I think if you manage to combine the climate finance with something that is bankable and has other objectives that you meet through that, your chances of success of getting especially loan-based finance is a lot higher. So I hope that answered the question.
Excellent. So normally my colleagues who have moderated before me would ask for everyone to say one point, one statement. But since we're out of time, I'm just going to ask for one word. One word for each person to say how they see what's the next focus should be to make co-benefits most achievable. I can pick some of the words you have said and label it to you, but I prefer it. No? No political leadership? No best practice? Yes, maybe that too. That's also allowed. What not to do? Okay, one sentence.
It's cross-sectoral cooperation.
That would be one word for me.
One
word.
Two and a half.
I would have to say the this idea of multiple objective. Not planning, but multiple objective kind of analysis in the way that Zambia did it.
Huh, Philip, you picked what I was going to say. I always say interagency coordination, but that's not one word. I'll go with social cohesion. I liked the panel in the morning. That goes with both the bottom-up, top-down approach. So we need to be alive to that. But sorry, Maron, I know that you need. So I want to say that it depends on the country context. Yeah. So bottom-up approach for us, because of the decentralization agenda, that has to work, and it will work. Because in the recovery project, we found that we were calling it the blended approach. So it depends in the sector where you want those climate actions, so you may have to use both. It's sort of, back and forth. But then there are some aspects where you just need to zero in on the bottom up, because they know where the issues are. And so for the social economic core benefits to be actualized, you need to make sure that you involve them. The implementation will be easier. Otherwise, we have a lot of policies, strategies, plans, but they don't yield anything. So we need to get it right. Sorry, Maron.
I think you should apologize to the next group. Well, thank you all for joining us, and I really appreciate that you took up the challenge.